I need to tell you about my mom. My mom is one of the kindest people I know, and she's got big hair. She's had it since the 80s, and she's kept it for 33 years, and it keeps getting bigger, so I think she keeps her secrets in there. Can we call that joke? And she's got this big smile, this big laugh, you can see that, and I said, that's on a really nice shirt. And one of the greatest gifts she's given me, one of the things she loves more than anything in the world, aside from maybe her children and those dogs of hers, is music. And I need to take a breath, hold on. She loves music so much that on the day I was supposed to come out of her womb, she was at a Bob Seger concert. She must have known that I'm perpetually late for basically everything, and I wasn't coming out that day, but he was her favorite, so I totally agree. So, she was 18 when she had me. Where am I supposed to be aimless? She was 18 when she had me, just a teen mom in the world, trying to figure out how to do her own adulting, and then suddenly there's this tiny, adorable creature that's here. There's this tiny creature in her hair. And so we grew up together, my mom and I. And we were friends more than mother and daughter. But one of the greatest gifts she's given me is her love of music. As you can see, it's a problem. She indoctrinated me at a young age, very young. We listened to hair metal, power pop, country music, everything. I love Pat Benatar, Joan Jett, Lita Ford, Scandal. Yeah. Garth Brooks, George Strait, Trisha Yearwood. I love Dolly Parton. I love Dolly Parton so much I named my dog Dolly Parton. She's very popular on the internet. I discovered David Bowie in my uncle's truck after going to see a Jean-Claude Van Damme movie. I was probably way too young to be seeing. I love the Moody Blues, George Harrison, the Beach Boys. Points, I like music, okay? My first concert was Neil Diamond, just before or just after Hurricane Andrew decimated my hometown. This picture is not of a lake, that is a street in Miami, right by where I went to high school, right by where I grew up. And Neil Diamond sang this song you might know called Dese'Rae. And I was like, wow, he's the theme! I can't Cher and Rizzo were my heroes. And I watched Greasy Dirty Dancing and Beaches and Footloose. And I danced around in my kitchen and my living room in this unselfconscious way that children do. And I remember this afternoon. It's one of my earliest memories. My mom and I are not yet. My mom and I are in a car, and we're driving down the street, and she used to quiz me, and I still do this to people in my life, I'm sorry if it's ever happened to you. She'd be like, who sings this song? Or, what is this song about? And I'd be like, but on this particular day, the hard song, All I Want to Do Is Make Love to You, came on the radio. You guys know the song? Yeah. So my mom said, do you know what this song is about? No. I did not. And she explained it to me. She told me about as we were driving past this lake that became the backdrop to some of my first kisses. She told me about it, and she was like, there's the narrator has lust for a stranger, and then she told me about the infidelity and the deceit, and then she told me the twist. The reason for all of it, this whole song, was infertility. She didn't use that word because I was tiny. The narrator wanted so desperately to have a child that she was willing to pick up anyone off the street to make that happen for her herself. So as I continued to grow, my mom continued to illustrate life through music for me. She instilled in me a deep, deep appreciation for lyrics, the rawness of emotion in music, the joy and the heartbreak. We are still looking at two fine lyrics. But ultimately, this is what helped me learn to process my emotions when puberty and depression struck in quick succession. Hey, Ryan. Music became an important tool for me. An important tool. I could apply my mom's questions to my life and her, how she taught me music, to find answers. What is it about, and how does it make me feel? John Acuff said, "The scars you share become the lighthouses for people who are headed for the same rocks you hit." Words and music, musicians and writers became my lighthouses. They became the people and the sounds and the words remembered that shored me up when I needed shoring, and that helped me bounce along when I was so happy I got my chest released. They reflected my own feelings back at me when I didn't see that in anything or anyone around me, which was really helpful. They say that smell is the strongest sentiment right now. But for me, it's music. It's auditory. It's song. There are songs tied so deeply to specific memories that they take me right back into those moments when I hear them. Boys in the back of Rick's brand new VW Bug when I was just starting to come out to my friends when I was 15 or 16. A Dishwalla song on repeat. When I'd hide in my room and hurt myself. When I was so sad. When I couldn't stop crying. When I couldn't understand what was happening to me. I felt alone and lonely. I felt like my parents would never, ever, ever understand me. I felt like nobody would ever understand me. I felt useless and hopeless and futile. And for the first time, like maybe dying would solve my problems. Shania Twain for my first kiss with my first love. We're having some glitch. And the national one I wanted to wallow. a while to realize that as much as music could lift me up, it could also bring me down, and I had to teach myself not to do that. If you're sad, do not listen to The National. Promise. Walk the Moon, when I realized that I could actually have a loving, healthy, passionate relationship that I always wanted and thought I'd never find, my unicorn.
Palmer.
Lamar, PJ Harvey, Lou Reed, Veruca Salt, when they made their comeback, Mr. Castles, Amanda Palmer and Irene Wine, this was supposed to happen before, and finally, Heart. I was one of two photographers in a venue filled with 18,000 people, and she was right in front of me, and I'm like, whoa. And what I learned was that these are real people. And when you strip the beats and the strings and the percussion and the searing guitars, they're people sharing their stories. They're sharing their pain, their triumphs, their lives. And that's the thing. The stories are what bond us to these artists, opening their chests and showing us their ignorance. Stories are what bond all of us to one another. Fundamentally, we are not much different from these people. They just look nice under the lights. Whatever, you know, they're pretty things. But it took me those 3 years working with musicians to realize that we can become each other's lighthouses. You don't need to be famous to be someone's lighthouse. Anyone can become anyone else's lighthouse. And that was the impetus for my project with this. I've always been willing to talk about my feelings, about my experience, and share my ridiculous stories. Some of you guys saw some really interesting stuff yesterday. But I didn't see that in anyone I knew. Also, however, I knew that I was not alone. That somewhere, there were people like me. Every kind of person, too. Not just the people you'd expect to have lived experience of suicide attempt and suicide outcome. And they were lost, and they were afraid. And they were shamed, and they were forced into silence. And I wanted to bring them out of the dark. Because the stories of people with lived experience are valid, they're valuable, they're real, and they need to be told. That's the website. For those of you who are not familiar with the project, know that this is a series of portraits paired with the true stories of suicide attempt survivors nationwide. I wanted to use the skills that I learned in the music industry. I would meet attempt survivors and I would say, tell me your story. No holds barred, no anonymity, open and honest, completely real. And then I would make a portrait. What do you look like when you share your deepest, darkest moments with a stranger, no less? When you set them free, what do you look like when you set that free? What does it feel like when you look into that stranger's eyes and you own that proudly? When it's okay to own that proudly? Before I started the project, it's been a whole year paralyzed because this was a big, scary idea. I didn't know where to find attempt survivors. Where do you find them? Now there's nothing wrong with that, but I didn't have the right gear. I had the right gear. But I didn't have the right gear. I didn't have the skills. Everyone I knew would think I was crazy. Professionals would tell me that what I was doing was dangerous. That was my biggest fear. I interviewed Tori Anderson in the winter of 2009. Let me tell you, that was a good day. And I asked her how she combats fear, because I'm really interested in fear. She said, you know that saying, if it's too loud, turn it up? If you're being intimidated by an idea or a thought, you have to hold your ground and look right in the eye. So I did. I started working on this project in 2011. Finally. Since then, why don't I get more to clicker, guys? Since then, I've traveled to 22 cities across the US, including this one, and I've interviewed as of 2 days ago. 149 suicide attempt survivors. And they looked their fear in the eye and they gave it the finger. Because they knew that despite the discrimination, despite the wayward glances, that this was important, that it could help somebody, that other people with lived experience need to know that they are not alone. And maybe the whole idea was based on intuition. But research does support it. Science! In 2003, Oregon and Spiegel both published papers indicating that public attitudes are most challenged and the greatest positive effects occur when average people, your mom, your coworkers, your friends, come out of the shame closet and share the stories of their struggles with mental health. And maybe we're not always the most reliable of narrators. I'm certainly not. Maybe we're awful, mean, oppositional, hiding in our rooms, crying until 5 a.m., just sobbing forever, and your significant other is like, what do I do with you? I just want to sleep. My wife. just afraid of everything. Maybe we're not always likable. But these stories, our stories, are what breathe life into and out of every single one of us. Our stories help us bear this crushing, crushing weight. And in telling them, the weight is lifted and we can fly. I've come to think of suicide as an outcome of, more than anything, an inability to communicate. An inability to make the words match the feelings, assuming the words can even come out, assuming there is language that even exists for that kind of pain. It's an inability for others to hear those words. To not let their fear of death, or their fear of liability, or their fear of sin, or their fear of shame, get in the way of what their ears and their minds can process. So if we can just learn to communicate better, if we, as people with lived experience, can do our best to try and express our feelings and our emotions, even if it's impossible, and if others can try to listen, even when it's so hard to empathize with something you do not understand, if you've never been suicidal, I'm willing to bet you don't get it. But if we can do that, the beams of our lighthouses will swing into sight and guide us safely away from the jagged rocks on the shore. Because the truth is, there is a total dearth of qualified professionals to handle suicidal crises. The truth is that the system is overburdened, you know this, and underfunded, and access to the system is a luxury. And the system can be traumatic for people like me. But our stories can inform and guide productive change within the system. Not only can they help it work better, more efficiently, more respectfully, more safely, but the stories also put our power in the hands of the people, not just the professionals. We can heal each other with our stories. That's all it takes. You guys know I love this quote. Brene Brown said, "The two most powerful words you can say to someone in crisis are me too." Much as I love her, my therapist is not around at 3 a.m., but my friends are, and my wife is. And my wife asks me, "What is this about? How does it make you feel? And most importantly, how can I help you?" In Lighthouse Keeping, Jeanette Wunderson wrote, "There it is, the light across the water. Your story, mine, his. And it has to be seen to be believed. And it has to be heard. In the endless battle of narrative, in spite of the daily noise," and there's a lot of it right now, "the story waits to be heard. The story waits to be heard." Our stories are the light across the water. Each of us can be a lighthouse, lighting up the darkness with a million points of light, one by one by one. Imagine them flickering on, showing us the path to lives worth living, and reminding us always to stay. Thank you.